So here we are practicing the one essential, which is right effort. And with that right effort, we're pushing the envelope of our understanding, pushing it along wherever we are. And obviously, everyone's at a different point in their clarity. So right effort just means pushing that clarity further and further and further. That's all that it is. It's not more than that. It's not less than that. I said in a video, was it yesterday or day before yesterday, things are about to get weird, very weird. And of course, they're always very weird here. I mean, weirdness is what existence is. But I said things are going to get really, really weird. And they have, of course, they are in the process of doing that right as we speak, and we'll continue. So one has to make a choice. Hopefully we won't try to do both. We won't try to follow all the weirdness. We just realize, yeah, it's going to be there. We know it's there. It's par for the course. And we'll say, well, let's decide to follow something else. Let's decide to follow freedom from the weirdness. And do that. And that's right effort. Just continue to make right effort. And so, you know, every video I make, I think maybe it's going to be the last one, because I don't want to waste anyone's time. And, you know, I'm not some perfect teacher, some great guru. I don't have, and not claiming any final recognition or isness here or anything like that. So, and maybe there's some, you know, some who have that and should be listened to, spend your time with them. But some seem to enjoy the videos, and I enjoy making them. I feel it's very helpful. I feel it is right effort. The greatest teaching of all is right effort. That is by far and away the greatest teaching. Without this teaching, everything is essentially, you know, your path is, your effort is futile. Yeah, so what we're teaching here is right effort. And so as far as that goes, I feel, you know, very justified in continuing with these videos. I know it takes time to watch these. I spent, you know, about an hour and a half last night viewing a satsang of a teacher. Very good, very helpful. My teacher used to say, as you play the instrument, so you hear the song. In other words, people would ask her, who is she? Who are you? And she'd say, as you play the instrument, you hear the song. Meaning, she's saying, I am whatever you take me to be. That kind of thing. So it's what you put into it. The effort is generally what you get out of it. And even a fool could be talking. And if you are fully present, something's going to click for you. You might even see, ah, a fool is talking. And I've been wasting my life listening to fools, you know, and suddenly you might have a tremendous push of clarity because you were fully present with the intention to get that push of clarity, and that happened. So last night I was very into getting a push of clarity, and this was actually prior to the unfortunate events of in the early morning of a Friday in Colorado. So I had this tremendous satsang with this young teacher, Bentinho Massaro. I think that's right. Bentinho Massaro. Yeah. He's very good. You know, I got a lot out of it. I got a lot out of it. I was right there, you know, and just, he was right on point, spot on. Very profound, very articulate, very focused, and just, you know, spot on. So that was my feeling. That was what I got out of it. Now someone else might get something, you know, entirely different out of that. Who's to know? So I got this tremendous boost, pushed clarity much further, and confirmation, assurance, confirmation that yeah, this the clarity here is going very much is centered on the same basic principles, same basic truth. And then today, that clarity continued to deepen. And I came across a tremendous, tremendous insight that is just a lot of them today. And they're not easy to speak about these types of insights. But what I saw is that the best teachers, the truth is that what we're feeling, what we're experiencing, what we're getting from them is the fact that there's no teacher there at all. And it's this is so unusual. You know, this experience is like, wow. And we think there's some super teacher there. But the fact is, the teacher has vanished. There is no teacher. There's only unconditional love there. There's only that overlay there. And there's no teacher. There's nothing to teach. So we feel something like this. This is extraordinary. You know, we feel, wow, there's something extraordinary going on here. And we assume there's a great teacher. And teacher, can you teach me this? And the teacher's gone. There isn't any teacher at all. And the letting go that is talked about actually is the letting go of the told teaching function. Letting go of the teacher. The best teachers are the ones who have let go of the teacher. There's no teacher there. So people assume that there's a teacher there, but what they're really telling you is let go of the teacher and just abide. Abide in this. Abide in the self. Abide in this unconditional love. That's all there is. That's all that's needed. No teaching is needed, really. There's some clarifications that can help, and those can be shared. But it's not like there is a teacher there. There's only the unconditional love there, abiding in itself. So this struck home very strongly. And we need to continue to make right effort now, because again, the weirdness of the world is escalating, going into overdrive, and don't want to get pulled along through that stuff. And it is possible here to make right effort and to gain greater clarity. It's very possible. I do it every single day. And sometimes you come across someone else who, you know, helps out. They have some very intense clarity, and you get something from it. It's good. As you play the instrument, so you hear the tune. There's another issue that's very, very important. The question of whether we have to get rid of all our problems, the samsaras of the world, the tendencies, and all the stuff, burn them away, get rid of them, sort of, or do we simply let go of all of that? And it seems like the emerging clarity is that we just let go of all of it. Stop trying to do anything about the world. And then you're free of it, you see. Really free of it. And then what my pointers are that all of existence is simply an appeal to magic. And it's a futile appeal. And it's all appeals are equally futile. Therefore, there is no ordering that needs to be done with existence at all. You don't have to elevate something or get rid of something else. You nearly need to see that all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. That's all you need to see. That's why I'm saying there's so little to teach that there is no teacher, really. But you simply need to do that one thing. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. So what is there to teach? Except to accept this fact and let go of any attempt. And then we say, well, what's going to happen to existence? Doesn't matter, does it? Doesn't matter. The fact is, existence is just a hypothetical scenario that we have, that we are imagining to, as an appeal to magic, as some way to appeal to magic, to generate magic, to somehow get the ability for us to be prior to the prime creator, prior to reality, prior to what is, prior to eternity, prior to endlessness, prior to essence, prior to direct experiencing. That we, prior to identity, we want to find some way so that there's some identity other than identity experiencing the one identity. And we're looking for some way to do this. And existence, there's several ways you can look at it. One is that it's a way that we forget what we are, which is certainly true. And another way of looking at it is that we are desperately attempting to find this power, this magical power that will make us prime creator, make us an identity which is experiencing the one identity, instead of the one identity simply being what it is. We're trying to experience the one identity. We're trying to realize the one identity. We're trying to recognize the one identity, as if there were something other than the one identity that could recognize it. You know, so this is you know, one way of talking about it. And so, existence is just this mishmash of attempts, throwing everything we can think of, you know, like to somehow get hold of this power, which there is no such power. Literally, it's like we're speaking to emptiness. We're speaking to nothing. We're appealing to nothing. We're appealing for nothing to be prior to everything, as it were, you know, and give us this power, give us this insight. We think there must be something other than reality, and we can be that if we just discover it. So we're on doing all this weirdness of existence, ceaseless weirdness. It really just, we're just trying to find some way. And since no way works, you know, we think, well, why don't we just, you know, stand on our head and do some weird stuff with our hands and wiggle our toes and sing a song and laugh and, you know, then go bang some drums and hug each other. And that's not even very weird. I mean, everything is completely weird here. Whatever we're doing, it's just has no effect, has no outcome, has no success. So we keep thinking, well, it will. We just have to keep working with it. And as we keep working with it, we keep coming up with all this, you know, variation and diversity of attempts. This massive diversity in existence of all sorts of attempts. We're not just on this planet, all over the universe. Just, you know, it's extreme diversity of attempts. All weird, very weird. And so, we don't have to do anything about it. We don't have to stop it. We don't have to change it. We don't have to try to make it unweird or do anything. We just have to recognize, to see, to accept the fact that all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. We don't need to draw any differentiations as far as what is weird and what is less weird, or what is more effective or what is less effective. You know, all these differentiations that our thinking is our judgment is constantly preoccupied with. We don't need to do that. So we can literally just be aware of the unconditional love, the overlay of all of existence that is equally present in all circumstances and all conditions. Why? Because there's only one judgment it makes, and that all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. Zero. They're all zero. So what is there to judge? There's no reason for judgment to enter in at all. We don't need to get rid of anything that arises. We simply see it as the nothing that it is. Meaningless. As far as our identity goes, it has no relevance whatsoever, zero. So then we just simply abide in our true identity. Or, as it actually, we will abide in the overlay, which is a perfect mirror of our true identity. That is actually what's happening. There's even a step beyond what the teachers are teaching in this world, is that their goal, that abide in the self, etc., that too is translated eventually into what's called direct experiencing. Right now the teachers talk about no experiencing, or experiencing of nothing, no experience. That which is not touched by experiencing. That is the intermediate step. And that is the goal for us here. I'm just establishing a slightly wider context, because it seems as if this is dismissing experiencing as if it's a terrible thing. No, it's only helping us get free of non-experiencing, really, which is what existence is. So it's, in other words, like you'd say, well, I'm not experiencing non-experiencing. I'm just abiding in this reflection, this overlay of unconditional love, which is an experience. Even you say, well, I'm having no experience, I'm just nothing at all. There's still the experience of that nothing. There's still the experience of no experience. There's still the abiding in that, it's still the experience. So in reality, it's direct experience of essence. Being essence, experiencing and flowing, that flowing and creativity. It's pure experience. It's something that we don't understand. We cannot grasp it. With the context we have, we cannot understand it at all. No way. It's not understandable. You have to actually just be it. You know, it's beyond what we can talk about, tell you the truth. So there has to be an intermediate step back, and that is this so-called, you know, no experiencing, or abiding in the self, or experiencing the overlay, or experiencing unconditional love, accepting unconditional love. It's all talking about the same thing, which is nothing, no experience, or no non-experiencing. The non-experiencing is seen as non-experiencing, and so you don't even differentiate at all. And so the mind becomes at some level quiet, in not struggling to differentiate, and it just rests in this non-differentiation mode, which is unconditional love. Another way to put it, the positive way to putting it, is unconditional love, which is there. In other words, we're all kind of in the same ballpark, and we're just, you know, working on clarifying it and actually feeling comfortable with this. All appeals to magic are nothing, because there's never a response, so it's not creative, okay? Creativity is cause and effect. There's no creativity without a cause and effect. You can't have creativity with only a cause, because a cause without an effect is not creative. So our appeals to magic don't get any answer back. There's no effects, real effects to this at all. So it's really nothing. It's nothing. It's a non-creating, it's a non-experiencing. And so we simply have to see all such attempts as one and the same attempt. It's like one person dressed up in many costumes. Yeah. Which is, that is all that it is. Just appealing to magic. Either we're gonna find a way to construct this magic, we're gonna find a way to release this magic, or we're gonna simply get lucky. It's just gonna happen without any cause whatsoever. All of those are just appeals to magic, because there is no power at all that can change reality, can change identity at all. There is no such thing. So we're appealing to that which isn't there, nothing. Just a fantasy, a wish, a whim. We're appealing to an insane whim and doing all these rituals, you know. Our life is like a living ritual. Everybody's life, the planet is like a living ritual. You know, everything that's happening, it's all happening as part of this massive effort toward to get that power, get that magic that will overcome reality, make us greater than reality. And so dropping the differentiation, dropping the judgment is really what these teachers are pointing to. They might say it in different ways. When dropping judgment, they call it, you know, no mind. You know, drop the mind or drop the pain body or all this kind of different terminologies. It's simply dropping judgment, realizing that all efforts are exactly the same. They're non-experiencing, non-creative, completely futile, empty, without any results and any meaning whatsoever. And therefore, the mind is not caught up in judgment of all of that. It's still all these things, we can still see it, everything arising, but it doesn't have any relevance as far as reality or identity. And there's no desire to have it continue. There's no desire to stop it, no desire to have it continue. It doesn't matter. Either way, it doesn't matter. So what becomes of all of this turmoil and antics that we call existence doesn't matter. And the fact is, it'll simply, it's like this. When we stop our appeals, realize we're making appeals to nothing, I say, oh, okay, I don't need to do that anymore. That's foolish. We just simply stop making these appeals so they don't arise. Existence will simply, at some point, not arise anymore. That's all. Because there's no creativity here. None. There's nothing real in existence. It's just antics. It's just appeals to nothing, hoping for an answer. And we think, well, what happens if there is an answer? There never will be. So we can be sure that that is what those who have dropped the judgment, they can assure us of this, that everything's fine. Don't worry about it. So in that way, it's very valuable. From their standpoint, it's a steady state, not unconditional love. So they don't see themselves as, there's no teacher there, no teaching function or anything. They just are the steady state. That's what's being experienced. Or the no experience is being experienced. In other words, that which is untouched by all existence, all these antics and appeals to magic, which is untouched because we've just realized that it's all equally futile, and we realize, since it is, we've decided let's choose a different idea, a different goal. Let's choose not trying to be greater than reality. Let's try to just be what we are, accept what we are. And that gives rise to this overlay or unconditional love, which we just simply are experiencing just that. No judgment needed, because this isn't some shifting, changing, kaleidoscopic masquerade. You know, it's just straight, pure, immaculate, unchanging. So it almost like it is, it's like a reflection of experience itself, not experiencing. And we're used to thinking we're having all these experiences, meaning we're aware of all these antics and appeals to magic. But in this case, we're remembering experience itself. And so all this other stuff we realize is counterfeit. It's not really the experience itself. It's non-experiencing. At least in a symbol of that. And we're all pushing our clarity to the point where we can make the final judgment, which is that judgment isn't needed. And therefore, there doesn't need to be this person, this point in time and space and circumstance, which is a point from which to judge this non-experiencing, these appeals to magic. It's really a point by which we're trying to determine which appeals are better than others. And it's almost like we have to be in the midst of it to feel the impact of it, to make the different judgments and determinations. But when we realize it's all equally futile, why do we need to think of ourselves as any particular place in space or time or in any circumstance? We don't need to see ourselves that way anymore. So we can say we're everywhere and nowhere, and both and neither. It's not necessary to feel that we're a person, a body, a situation in time and space, and we're close to other situations and we're experiencing all these things. It's not necessary anymore. So we don't even have to think of ourselves at all, really. It's just unimportant. It has no relevance. There's simply the abiding in this unconditional love, this overlay, this perfect emptiness, perfect stillness, perfect non-experiencing, whatever you want to say. It's simply that is everywhere. So why worry about where you are, some you? If this overlay is everywhere, what concern is it about who am I or where am I? What concern is that? It's not really even a question anymore, is it? Because you can't possibly be without experiencing this overlay. It's everywhere, equally, equal quality, equal quantity, eternally unchanging, flawless, pure. So why even think about who am I at that point? Or where am I? What am I doing? It has no relevance. Because wherever you are, wherever anyone wants to think you are, etc., still the same experience. So it becomes meaningless at that point to even think about, you know, who am I, what am I, what am I doing, what's going on. And as such, there's no teacher, there's no there, there's no longer any belief in someone being somewhere, that there's a person or a identity that is some particular place. People would ask my teacher, you know, where are you going? And she goes, what do you mean? I'm already everywhere. There's no place I can go. I'm everywhere. She says, I find myself simply wandering around within my own self. That's all. Because if everywhere is one and has the same unconditional love, then you're always there. And what need is there to, you know, try to delineate specific places as far as where you are, because it's the same. Practically, see, there's practically, of course, we know practically, but that's not the point. That's not what we're getting at. Is the so-called loss of self, loss of personal identity, all that stuff. It's not a loss. It's an irrelevancy. It becomes, you know, a non-relevant issue entirely. Because there's no place where you're not. In other words, where what you're experiencing now in this time and place and situation is exactly the same that you'd experience any time and place, a perfect reflection of unconditional love. So there's no place where you would not be experiencing this. So it's very unimportant and meaningless to say, well, where am I or what am I, etc. It's always perfectly obvious that wherever you go, you're there. You're here now. Wherever you go, you're there. So you're everywhere and always present, always the same, you know, and so it just that realization, seeing that, just supersedes, you know, concern with the personal idea of a person being in a specific place and time and circumstances, which we see as different than some other place and time and circumstances, for the purpose of trying to come up with an appeal to magic that works. We have to differentiate, because we know, you know, that over there doesn't work. So we feel we have to be different than that, because that doesn't work. We know. So each one of us feels that we're unique and different. We have to feel that way as long as we're appealing to magic. We have to. There's no way to change that. So when people talk about bringing peace to the world and all that kind of stuff, you know, that is just, it's empty talk. Because as long as we're making this appeal to magic, the world has to be the way that it is. And when we drop that appeal, then the concept of a world loses all meaning, really. It becomes irrelevant. The whole universe becomes irrelevant, really. And so, and one is in unconditional love. Why does one need to talk about bringing peace anywhere? Peace is already everywhere. The overlay is everywhere already. So instead of talking about bringing peace to the world, talk about dropping judgment, making the final judgment that all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. See, do that. That's what Ramana says. Instead of cleaning all the thorns and stickers and stones off the path, just put on a pair of shoes. That's the way. That is the way. And so there is no, you know, there's no possibility of having the world as relevant and also having it peaceful. It's impossible. That's a complete contradiction. As long as people see the world as relevant, they will also see themselves as unique, and that the whole situation is actually based on, again, trying to be prime creator, greater than reality, greater, have an identity which is experiencing identity. And that has to give rise to appeals to magic, which has to differentiate, because nothing works. When you have a situation where it's impossible, what happens is you have this massive diversity and fragmentation and diversification, uniqueness, and all these different personalization. In other words, points of reference have to just be completely scattered all over the place. That's why you have the universe, all these different points of reference. All these galaxies, all these planets, stars, systems, etc. All different points of reference. You have to have that because nothing works. And you have to hide the fact that nothing works by having this incredible enormity, okay, of different viewpoints. This enormity of different viewpoints in time and space, which we kind of obscures for us the fact that nothing works. That we're engaged in this folly. So, as long as we're trying to be greater than reality, we're engaged in complete folly and impossibility, and we have to obscure this with enormity and all these different diversities, diversified points of view. And when you have that, you're guaranteed you're going to have conflict. It's completely impossible to have peace. Completely impossible. It's ludicrous. Because nothing works. How can you have peace when nothing works? People are extremely frustrated. They're in extreme despair. They're in extreme fear. And they have to project that just to keep the delusion going. And when you project that, you think that in attacking others, you're freeing yourself from this, you know, fear, etc. You don't realize where it's coming from. So you just, you know, the game of trying to psychoanalyze existence as if somehow that's going to solve the problem. problem is ridiculous. What happens is we'll simply recognize all the projection and the guilt and all this kind of stuff, and it's okay, and it's still going to be there. It's not going to disappear. It's not going to disappear at all. It cannot. It's impossible. It cannot. The way to salvation is to make the final judgment that all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. You drop the judgment, and then just naturally you realize you don't need to even consider yourself as a point of view. And you don't even need this vast enormity of diversification of solar system, universe, and planets, etc. You don't even need that either. You don't need any of it. You don't need to get rid of it. You don't need to attack it. It just simply becomes irrelevant. You're everywhere. And you are, you know, eternal, unconditional love, and it's everywhere. Everywhere is that. It's all that. There's only that. And it's just, so, it just comes about easily and effortlessly and naturally, not by getting rid of anything, but just by seeing and saying, oh, you know, it's irrelevant now. It's really irrelevant. I don't need to think of myself as a person anymore. And of course, if there's no person, there's no teacher, really. There's no, vanished, gone, irrelevant. The other people, of course, will think there's a teacher there, but there's no there there. There's only an everywhere there. And so it's just, it's that is there. And we're pushing the envelope of clarity here. You know, we don't have to academicize. Is there a word? Academify it. We don't have to academify it. Like there's some teacher that's going to give us a PhD, the final PhD, post PhD. You know, of okay, now you're enlightened, now you got it, or your viewpoint is right. No, that's the opposite of what we're looking for. What will happen is we'll realize that there is no viewpoint other than unconditional love, which is everywhere. So it's not really a viewpoint, is it? The whole thing about a viewpoint, is it inherently presupposes another viewpoint. I have this viewpoint. Who has the viewpoint? I have this viewpoint. So there's a viewpoint somewhere, bringing up, you know, the other side of the coin. There must be another viewpoint somewhere else. And so unconditional love is not a viewpoint. And since it's everywhere, there doesn't need to be a viewer of a viewpoint, so to speak. So we look at these teachers and gurus who are completely aware of this, completely clear-cut, who are experiencing this unconditional love, not as in any particular place or anything, just that it's they're abiding in it. The abidance is there. Effortless abidance everywhere, always. And then they just reassure us. They reassure us that this is all okay. They give us that big reassurance. This here is clarification, which is a type of reassurance, which I just happen to be good at, having done so much of it. But the big reassurance comes from those who have actually made the final judgment, that no judgment is necessary. That's the final judgment. The final judgment is that no judgment is necessary. Because only a fool, only foolishness, a foolish whim would try to draw differentiation between different attempts to accomplish the impossible. As if they were somehow different. Is there some meaningful difference there? If there's no meaningful difference, then what is there to judge? Really? Only a fool would keep on judging, right? Exactly. So really, we're all fools, of course, because we are continuing to judge the good, the bad, and the ugly. And it's foolish because, again, these are just different costumes on the attempt to accomplish the impossible and be greater than reality, be prime creator, something prior to prime creator, which is impossible, it's futile. So we are, again, going towards final judgment, which is that no judgment is needed. And we wouldn't even need the final judgment if it weren't for the fact that we are have been attempting judgment for so long, attempting to see differences where there aren't any. We see differences where there aren't any, and no differences where there are difference, where there is a difference. We don't see it. In other words, we don't see a difference between lies and truth, but we think we see all sorts of meaningful differences between different costumes of a lie. You know, we think we see, oh, this is different. So there is no difference between lies. They're all equally untrue. But there is a difference between truth and lies. And that is, only truth is true. Whereas a lie will say that truth and lies can both be true. Or it will say, quote-unquote, you know, integration. We can integrate it. Integrate it. Let's bring it together. Let's blend it. Let's all be one. Yeah. Even in talking about oneness, we're still kind of thinking of a place, and it's like set in somehow it's set, but really, unconditional love seems to be even beyond the oneness. It overlays the oneness because oneness is still kind of a concept that we have. Actual oneness is not a concept, you know. It's just the equal presence of truth everywhere. So there's nowhere where truth isn't true. So we can say, you know, it's all one, but it really means that there is nowhere where truth isn't true. So don't even need to, you know, speak of oneness or not oneness, etc. Doesn't even have to get into concepts at all. It's just a fact that is experienceable. We can know that fact. It's even beyond what we think of experiencing. It's more of like a direct knowing. And a knowingness, just a knowingness. Just there. It's just there. And so academically, you know, what can we do with all this? Really, what can we do with all of these pointers here academically? What can we do with them? Nothing. Nothing. So it's I always say, don't make the path an academic exercise, because you'll build an obstacle in front of you that you feel you can't get past. Because you'll say, my gosh, I spent all this time taking notes, and what do I do with them now? I gotta do something with them. And then that becomes the millstone around the neck. The Achilles heel to the path, you know, to dropping the path. Since there's judgments are useless, you know, there's really no path at all. Never has been any path. There's no path, no teacher. Because even a teacher implies a point of view, you know. There's only truth, unconditional love, and us realizing that all judgments are equally meaningless. All judgments of lies are equally meaningless. There's nothing to differentiate between different varieties of the same lie. The belief, you know, that there's some magic, some power that we can, that will enable us to be greater in reality. That is the fundamental lie. And who's telling that lie? We are. We're simply hoping for that. Just hoping for it. That's why we all have this hope. Hope and change, you know. Let's hope. Let's hope for a change. Let's hope for some luck. Let's hope we get lucky. We're never going to get lucky in that way. We're never going to find that change. So hope and all that, it's useless. Futile. And so judgment itself is futile. And seeing, the final judgment sees that all judgment is equally futile. Don't need any. As long as we're trying to differentiate between different forms of the same lie, as if there was, you know, we're deluded, we're hung up. We have a point of view, we have a person, we have a place, we have a situation. We feel vulnerable. We feel conflicted, feel like we might need to attack or protect ourselves or protect, you know, what we see in our judgments. So, you know, this is better than fixating on the news and the weirdness. You know, let's not even call it news, let's call it weirdness. Yes, it really is. The whole existence is completely weird. Because we're trying to draw differentiations, there is none. It's all false hope. And nothing is taking place. It's actually absolutely nothing taking place in existence. Nothing. Nothing has ever happened in existence. Absolutely nothing has ever happened. Zero. Which is okay because nothing has to happen in existence. It's not like we somehow failed. How can you fail to accomplish the impossible? There's no failure there. What was never possible in the first place, how can you say that you failed to accomplish it? That's just simply an absurdity. We're not, you know, the only thing we're guilty of is entertaining absurdity, but it has no effect, so why, we're not really, what guilt doesn't really have any meaning, does it? Because guilt implies some type of harm or something, but we haven't harmed anything. We haven't harmed truth. By indulging in absurdity, in the whim of absurdity, failing to see that there's no differences among all these ridiculous gimmicks we're using, and antics, and appeals, and rituals, and all, you know, this mishmash, all this stuff, we keep coming up with more stuff. We come into this world and everyone teaches us, come on, you got to be really creative. You know, be creative, be industrious, you know. I say, come on. And like I was like saying, for what? What are you talking about? You're crazy. Don't need to. And they say, well, you know, your vision, whatever you're seeing is interfering with your creativity. That's what I was told, you know. I used to be able to see certainly vastly better than I do now. And I could see the totality, in the subtle realms and everything, and just people would say, hey, you're very imaginative, but, you know, it's getting in the way of real creativity. It's like saying, like abiding in reality is somehow getting in the way of real creativity. Is that true? Is actually getting in the way of non-creativity. And they'd say, you know, you're not making the right differentiations. You know, I said, no, yes, I am. I'm seeing that there are no differentiations to make. But now that, you know, they'd bring in the heavyweights, you know, the educators, and say, wow, you know, this guy's got a lot of potential, but we really got to find out a way to educate him. Yeah, we've all been through that to some greater or lesser degree. Got to be educated, meaning we got to learn how to make judgments here, make differentiations, see different things as meaningful differences here. We got to be creative in our rituals and our antics and our appeals to magic. We got to be very, very creative. In other words, come up with something new. We're always being praised. You got to come up with something new, something different. You know, everybody's eager for that. Every, you know, every crop, every generation, the children they come in, and the adults are eager for them to be here. So, oh, thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. We're so happy you're here, because what we're doing isn't working, and we need new ideas. We need new energy. We need new imagination. We need new judgments, new viewpoints. You know, new all this stuff. We're so desperate for it. Thank you're here. Okay, go to work. Go to work. Go to work. And here I come. You know, like just sitting there, like. I don't have anything I need to do. I don't need to make any judgments or differentiations or come up with anything new or all that kind of stuff. And here comes a hummingbird. Oh, look at this. Hello. Whoa, right above the camera. It was just right here, about 10 inches right above this camera, level with the camera. Maybe you could even hear it. I don't know. Wow. Just saying hello to me. And people say, oh, you know, this one's, something's not right. Something's not right. I mean, he's not helping us out. So I kind of fell through cracks into disapproval. I was disapproved of everywhere. I just had this general cloud of disapproval around me because I wasn't helping out, you know, so to speak. So I felt really conflicted. I said, wow, I thought I came here to help, and everybody thinks I'm not helping at all. So, this is like, you know, very bizarre. And I said, well, if I stick to my guns, I just, you know, continue to not try to differentiate and not try to judge and not try to come up with some new ritual antics, and people are just going to completely ignore me and think that I'm terrible. I said, that's not helpful. So then I tried to come up with something, which, you know, didn't turn out well because it's futile. And so I just tried to come up with something faster, you know, faster futility, you know, which is what you do is you burn yourself out. A lot of creative people burn themselves out. And they take drugs because they're so fried, their nerves are so fried, they've been trying to come up with more and more creativity, faster and faster, better and better. You know, something to, they want to contribute. They want to contribute. Contribute. And so they burn themselves out, get very sick, very frail, and end up, you know, going off the deep end. Really, really, really bad. And a lot of those stories don't end up well at all. And I'm trying to have, for this one to have a happy ending because, you know, I felt like everybody just would be so disappointed if I didn't try to make a contribution the way that they thought I should supposed to contribute. You know, I just said, wow, you know, I don't want them to be that bummed out and just come here for no reason at all. So, you know, you go along with that. And, you know, very few just come in here and stick with their guns and stick with truth. Very few. And they don't even care if no one pays any attention to them or not. It makes no difference. And they somehow stick it out, and then they become great, great, great helpers. I don't know. And I wasn't quite able to stick it out. Almost. But not quite. Because, you know, very, very rare that anyone actually does stick it out and just knows exactly, you know, that the disappointment and disapproval of the world has no effect on them. That's great. Those who are able to do that are tremendous. My teacher was that way, and Anandamayi Ma is that way. Never felt the slightest disturbance from any disapproval. A lot of people disapproved of her a lot. They thought she was worthless, retarded, and worthless. Never amount to anything, and never make any contribution in the world whatsoever. And it didn't bother her in the slightest bit. In fact, she was perfectly content to just simply sit still like a statue. When they told her to sit still, she literally would turn into a living statue without any motion whatsoever. It seemed like she wasn't even breathing, no pulse, nothing. No movement for hours and hours and hours and hours on end, and just could go on all night. Just wouldn't move. So it had no desire, you know, one way or the other. No judgment. And so people gradually, somehow, you know, people began to say, well, maybe this person might could be this could be helpful. Maybe somehow started to kind of people say, hey, you know, you seem to be very, very otherworldly. You know, what's going on here? And they started inquiring about it. And then they began to get help from that, you know, began to tune into it. But from her standpoint, if nobody tuned in, it didn't bother her at all. If everybody disapproved, it didn't bother her one bit. She said she was never bothered by criticism, one slightest bit. Never inconvenienced. You know, so this attitude is extremely rare here. Extraordinarily rare. The rest of us, we are bothered if everybody feels that we're not contributing. You know, it does bother us. For her, if everyone in the world felt she contributed nothing, wouldn't cause the slightest disturbance in her. None. And so that's the ultimate. And then you get the ultimate teacher, potentially ultimate help. If you inquire into it, if you make the inquiry into that condition, you say, why are you not bothered by anything? You see, that's the inquiry. So if you, it takes wise people, and India had those wise people at that time. There were very wise people who saw her, and immediately they said, wait a minute, you know, this, what is this? This one has no ego, doesn't care if no one pays attention to her or not, makes absolutely no difference. They noticed something, they came up to her and said, you know, who are you, what are you, you know, we think that maybe you're in some very high spiritual condition, can you tell us, you know, if this is true or not? And they started inquiring, and she just would started responding to their inquiry. Without any inquiry, she would have done nothing. That's a fact. So this is, you know, insight. Looking at these great teachers gives you enormous insight into truth. Because she would have just have sat quietly, because there's no judgments to make. Everything's already perfect. She's not here to do anything. Not here to change anything. So, and not here to, you know, bring some kind of new differentiation or, you know, be creative, so to speak, at all. Write books or do anything. Nothing. Everything's perfect. Everything's already perfect. We just have to drop our absurdity of trying to, you know, chasing after nothing and screaming at this nothing. Hey, help us out. Nothing. Everybody's so busy chasing after this nothing, they don't even turn to what really does help. You know, the great teachers, teachers in quotes, the great ones, the great beingness that arises here from time to time, knowing itself to be itself. Not trying to be other than that, knowing that there's no need to differentiate or judge between illusions, between different forms of a lie, between different forms of futility, no need. We can inquire into them, say, hey, you know, what's up with you? What is this? You know, can you shed some light on your condition? You know, make inquiry into that, and then they respond to that. Those are the great opportunities. And by us inquiring, we begin to find out, like, wow, you know, there's things are slightly different than I thought. And, you know, drop judgment. What is that? You know, we start to come across these great, great opportunities. We hear, like, final judgment. You know, what is that? Final judgment. Wow, that sounds very interesting, right? Then we start to inquire into that. Final judgment. What does that mean? Abide in the self. What does that mean? You know, and so we have to make inquiry. And these teachers are happy to respond, you know, to our inquiry like that. If we're really determined, you know, to know what is this truly? And I feel, you know, I feel like this is something I want. I feel you have something I want. There's something I want, and you are experiencing it. How can I have this, get this experience, or where did this experience, and they will, you know, tell you, you know, drop, make a final judgment that all judgments are equally futile. Trying to judge among attempts to accomplish the impossible is simply non-judgment. There's nothing to judge. There's nothing to judge in existence. There's nothing to judge. That's the final judgment. No, nothing to judge. Never was anything to judge here. So I do continue to bring these great teachers up, these great beings. We can say teachers for now, you know, understanding that it's goes beyond our idea of a teacher. It's like perfect non-teaching. Again, I said she was a perfect non-teacher, and I am a perfect non-teacher, because if we didn't inquire of her, she would just have done nothing. Because she knows there's nothing that needs to be done. So why on her initiative would she do anything? Would not. As a matter of fact, that she simply, as a housewife, she simply was cooking and cleaning and taking, being a housewife, flawlessly. You know, just, that's all she did. You just do this constantly, taking care of everything just perfectly, you know, and didn't have any desire to do anything other than that. Until someone started saying inquiry, say, wait a minute, who are you? You know, what you know, you're, I want you to, can you explain, you know, what's going on with you? Who are you? And then she, you know, started to respond to that. Still doing the cooking and the cleaning and all of that, and housekeeping, being a housekeeper and taking care of all social arrangements and everything. And then more people would inquire, and gradually the inquiry became so in extreme and intense that she had to let go of all that housework, because she had to respond to this inquiry. You know, couldn't just say, no, I'm not going to respond to the inquiry. No. Because truth does, you know, respond to truth. The desire for truth is met with response. And on the other hand, if the inquiry wasn't spot on, she'd just go silent, wouldn't say anything. Just sit there like a statue. Like this. No, it's not a situation of non-answering. It's just simply this condition of perfect bliss, just there. And then if an inquiry is made that is, you know, rings a bell, an answer comes out, a response comes out. Very interesting. Tremendous teachers. And so there are teachers now, non-dual teachers. There are various teachers around, you know, and paying attention to them is helpful as well too. But I always like to bring up the my one of my teachers and Maharshi and Jesus Christ, those teachers, because inquiry into them is very fruitful. You get a tremendous expansion, because it's like you have to somehow put a lot of effort into the inquiry, because they're so unusual. You know, and ordinary answers don't apply at all. I just had, you know, it's like, wow, how can I wrap my inquiry around this one? You know, just, I don't see how it's possible based on my beliefs to make heads or tails of this. I really don't. And so a lot of people, they don't do inquiry. They just, you know, say, oh, great mother, thank you for being here. Love you so much, great mother. And that's it. So, but no, they're here for inquiry. She responded to it, you know, very learned. Pundits would come and for hours grill her, you know, and she'd respond. And then they'd come away saying, wow, you know, that was tremendous, wow. And then they come back for some more inquiry, you see. Like that. But most people took her as some potential form of magic, like the magic maker, the magician, who could provide the power that we're seeking. That's most took her that way. Most take all teachers that way, as a matter of fact. The non-dual teachers, the teachers you see today, I'm looking at them, and most that come to these teachers today, exactly the same as it was in the past, they think the teacher has found the power that they're looking for. And so they're trying to find a way. They don't think the teacher really wants to share it. They gotta try and find a way to get it from the teacher. The teacher's gonna somehow have mercy on them and tell them, okay, you know, here's the power. Ah, someone's just arrived home. Okay. So they come there and they go through the satsang, and you know, they put on a nice act. Very interested, very earnest, interested. But there's a meta purpose behind that. They're looking, okay, says, how did the teacher find the power to become greater than God? How do they do it? And what is it? It's there. I think I see it. It must be there. But I'm not quite sure, you know, and how can I get it? And how can I keep it? You know, they're thinking of all these things in their mind. How can I get it? How can I keep it? I'm going to have to steal it. Are they going to share it? Or, you know, if they share it, how long are they going to share it with me? And so there's this underlying paranoia, concern, and the inquiry doesn't flow. Doesn't really flow. It's very rarely have I heard any true inquiry of any of these teachers. If at all, you know. Maybe a little bit of inquiry. Just 1 minute here. Maybe it's a good time to take a break. I'll be right back. It's always good to take a break from all this verbiage. Just like that, we're back. See, that's how to do it. Take a break. Okay. I was speaking about my observing. I did inquiry into Ananda Mahamudra, Mahamudra Maharshi, and Jesus Christ, even though they're not here and physically. The record of them being here is such that it is possible to actually do inquiry. I was able to feel the essence and then inquire into that. So I have done a tremendous amount of inquiry, very serious. Now, so I'm looking at the teachers of today and those who come to see them and saying, you know, what's going on here? You know, is inquiry, how much inquiry is taking place here? And so I'm saying, not much. And so it's almost like the teachers, they have to talk a lot, kind of talk and fill in the time. You have a video, you know, you need to fill in the time. You can't just sit like a statue. I mean, Ananda Mahamudra would sit like a statue. Hard to get video of her because you never knew what she was going to do. Because if the inquiry wasn't spot on, she might just leave. She might be silent, just go somewhere else. You never knew what she was going to do. Never knew. Because if she felt the pull of inquiry somewhere else, she literally would leave a room and go there. If the inquiry where she was weak, she might just be quiet and do nothing. And even if it was like a thousand miles away, if there was an intense desire for inquiry of her, she would get up and say, we're leaving, we're going. And they said, people would say, where are you going? We're going. Say, I'm not saying, we're just, let's go. And then she'd get a train ticket and phew, gone. And then would arrive there where this desire for inquiry was. And then she'd knew where it was, and she'd go to the area, the people, the person, whoever it was, and then here I am, and sit down, and then the inquiry would begin, just like that. Totally, like, spontaneous. Wherever the pull was coming from, that's where she'd go. So that's why if people wanted to stay, they had to be very intense on their inquiry. And they knew it. They were scared. They said, oh my gosh, if we just fool around, she's gone. So there's very serious inquiry, and they would do all sorts of spiritual chanting and prayers and intense spiritual focus and fasting, and do everything they could do in an inquiry just so to get her to stay, because they knew if they weren't serious or they weren't spot on, gone, gone, she'd be gone. That's a great motivator, isn't it? Yeah. Gone. And so nowadays the teachers, they kind of need to say something, you know. For instance, Muji will say, you know, come on guys, you know, you got to step it up, you know, you're not really hitting me with the strong stuff at all, you know, just true, it's true, what he's saying is true, you know. It's just, you know, it's, he says, I wish you would, you know, really bring it, you gotta bring it, come on. And if they don't bring it, yeah, he's gotta do, you know, kind of a song and a dance and keep the show going, but it wants, you know, more deeper inquiry, bring it. And people come up and say, oh, can you give me a hug and thank you, you know, I have a this relationship I'm in right now. You know, I'm just wondering, is this the one for me or not? And how can I look at this? And okay, you know, but you know, it's not as intense as it could be, the inquiry. I just don't see it. I don't see it in the world. That's very, very sad. I mean, you know, the India of Ananda Maya Ma was pretty serious spiritual situation there, very intense. You know, it was really a very, very serious thing. I mean, we're talking about renunciates, all the renunciate orders. I mean, that is serious business. You know, you make a vow and you're a renunciate, and you have to live by that the rest of your life, and you're expected to, you know, put enormous effort in. And you have all these renunciate orders there. And you have all those renunciate orders have all sorts of degrees of intensity of effort and inquiry there. And so, you know, she would have, these people would be saying, you know, hey, you know, we think you are extremely helpful for us and we want to know what's going on here. And then they'd start asking very, very, very pointed, intense questions and inquiry on the most, you know, esoteric and deep types of differentiation, you know, differentiations or non-differentiation, you know, very fine points of advanced theology and philosophy and spiritual understanding. Most intense types of inquiry of her, you know. And so then she's happy, say, oh, I'm, you know, sure, respond to all that, respond, respond, like that. But gosh, today the level of inquiry is, holy smokes, it's like, kind of like, what do I need to do to get an A on this test? What do I need to do to get my spiritual PhD? You know, it's like that. And they're afraid, you know, they say, I don't want to get the teacher angry. I don't want to really inquire too much. So they're looking like, well, what do I need? What does the teacher want me to say so that I get the passing grade? The problem is that too many people in today have had academic lives, starting in preschool up through, you know, through high school and then through college and then through graduate school and then postgraduate school. And all of that totally trains you to find out what does the teacher want me to reflect back to them, as if the teacher has some power that you want them to share it with you. The power is the power to bestow a degree, right? That's the power really that people are after. Why? Because that gives us entitlement. When you have advanced degrees, you have entitlement. And entitlement gives us the best opportunity here to avoid all the maintenance work of this world, which is what, let's face it, let's be honest. Honesty is by far and away the best policy. Nobody wants to do that maintenance work. Nobody wants to do it. We're all desperately struggling to get up to a level where we can pay others to do the dirty work for us. That's a fact. And you know, most people going to satsang, they're hoping, you know, hey, I want to get some power here, where I feel entitled, where I don't have to, you know, do the dirty work here, do all the maintenance work, because this entire world is just a rotting corpse, really, that has to be ceaselessly maintained. You know, who's gonna repaint the house and reset the doors and redo this and redo that and fix the car and collect the garbage, fix the redo the plumbing? Who's going to redo the streets? Who's going to redo this? Who's going to build this? Who's going to dust the house, clean all the house? Who's going to do all the cooking and the dry? Who's going to do all that stuff, you know, that's burdensome? Nobody wants to do it here, as a fact. And we all want to get free of that horrible burden. And so we're looking for some way. And here's the spiritual teacher that seems to be completely free. They have no burdens. We say, oh my gosh, this one is free of burdens. And so we say, how can we be free of burdens too? We don't want to clean our house for the rest of our lives. You know, we don't want to mow the lawn twice every week. We don't want to do all the watering, you know, care for our yard. You know, we don't want to just do all this nonstop, never-ending maintenance work in every possible way. You know, the stuff that if you have the money and the power that you pay others to do, right? We would all love to be free of that. Let's be honest, absolutely. So we think that the guru, the teacher here, is has no burdens. They think, oh my gosh, they're free of all that. How can I be free of that too? So we try to figure out, you know, how can we get the guru to share with us this entitlement that they seem to have? And so we're just trying to mirror back to them what we think they want to hear. So there isn't a real inquiry taking place, you see. Whereas in a renunciate culture, you've already renounced the world. So it's understood that you're not going to necessarily be a maintenance person, because you've accepted the path, the most difficult path of all, which is to get free of delusion. And that's respected. It's understood you're not just trying to get a free ride. Okay? Very important. It's a very serious thing. So there, inquiry can be intense. They're not worried about the guru's feelings or this and that. They're not trying to get the guru to share some entitlement with them at all. They're trying to get to the truth. So real inquiry can take place. But here, where we, you know, most of us, either we pay for someone else to do all the maintenance work, or we have to do it ourselves, you know. And most of us are right on the edge, like we can barely afford, you know, to have others, you know, do the dirty work. I mean, for me, I've always had to do all my own work. Terrible. Hate it. Yeah, I had to fix my own car. When anything happened, I had to fix it. Had to do all the gardening, all the maintenance work, all the fixing. And the fixing for others too. Janitorial work, collecting garbage, paving roads, pumping gas. I've had to do all maintenance work for other people. Because why? I couldn't afford to pay anyone else. If I could afford it, you know, well, honestly, of course I would. But here I have to do all the, you know, the cleaning, whatever. All of it. It's terrible. Hate it. Absolutely hate it. As anyone really does, if they're honest. Especially if you come from a class of people who can afford to pay others, which I do, where everyone I know, they pay for all that stuff. They don't do it themselves. You know, they might do a little gardening for fun or something, but no, they have others do the maintenance work for them. So, because, well, they got college degrees, they got entitlement. So, of course, people go to the guru saying, and this culture, you know, like, wow, you know, I don't want to slip down. I don't want to slip down and be stuck with the maintenance work. I don't want to be cleaning up other people's messes. Okay? So, you know, guru, you got to help me. You got to help me. You got to help me. And so they're very careful, you know, because the stakes are high. They think, wow, the guru might get mad at me. They won't help me if I make the wrong inquiry and don't parrot back to them what I think they want to hear. And then I won't get the entitlement from them. And people are desperate. You know, they want to get the guru to say, ah, you've got it. Okay, now you can be a teacher. They want the guru to sanctify them. Like, okay, you know, you've got it. You got it. So now you can teach and say that you're my student, you know, and then, you know, of course, you have that whole entitlement situation going for you at that point in time. And then you have others doing seva, or service, for you. Seva for a true teacher is completely legitimate, because they are literally showing you the way to be saved from all maintenance. Saved from this world, which is, this world is nothing but maintenance. It's all impermanence, the rotting corpse. They're showing you the way to the maintenance-free world. The main reality is maintenance-free, 100% maintenance-free. Okay? Totally. They're showing you, everyone, the way. Both the elite, the entitlement people, and the maintenance people, everyone. So, from that standpoint, it is appropriate for save our service to those teachers to enable them, their time to be freed up to teach. But like, for instance, not in my mind, she did all the maintenance work. Before people inquired of her, that's all she did. She didn't have any sense of entitlement of anything. She did all the sweeping, all the scrubbing, the pot. I mean, she scrubbed all the pots and the pans. She cooked all the meals, cleaned all that, waited on her in-laws. She was the lowest of the low servant maintenance person until people started inquiring of her. And then, you know, she responded to that. And eventually people say, wait a minute, who do you think you are? You know, I mean, you're not doing the maintenance work anymore. And she'd apologize and say, I'm very sorry, you know, but I have to respond to this inquiry. I have no choice. I have to respond to it. And a lot of people thought she, you know, was high and mighty, trying to think, who are you? You're just this drudge servant, maintenance person, take care of all the terrible work that we don't want to do. That's what you're supposed to do for us. And here you are spending time with these learned pundits, you know. And eventually the people that came to her were so high up in the structure of Indian society. Famous people, powerful, famous, respected people, and people of renunciate orders, heads of renunciate orders. I mean, they would start coming to her, and then, you know, her family and other people would say, oh my gosh, you know, maybe she really, really is some very incredible being here, you know. But prior to that, they thought, you know, she's just a menial servant. She's just a dullard. She's not capable of doing anything other than just, you know, washing the pots and pans and doing the cleaning work. So there's no entitlement. It's not teaching entitlement. Except this, we're all entitled to be free of existence, free of this appeal to magic. That's what we're entitled to. So she is teaching ultimate entitlement, real entitlement. Real entitlement is literally permanent freedom, real freedom from all maintenance. Real freedom from all maintenance. You know, and so what I see in the world now is I don't see genuine inquiry really taking place, because people are scared, because they don't want to upset the guru, the teacher, and they're only trying to find out, what does the teacher want me to say? If the teacher wants me to say I got it, I'll say I got it. If the teacher, you know, wants me to say I got it because of this, because I have no self, because I'm experiencing nothing, that's what I'll say. And I'll go along with that. Whatever they want. I just want to get some degree, some, you know, I'm now Shri this, or I've realized the no self, or something that then, you know, they can have some seva for them, some service for them, and so they can teach. You know, that's just the truth. There's nothing wrong with speaking the truth, because I'm having to explain why the inquiry is not taking place here. It's not really. Because real inquiry could care less about whether the teacher gives them a blessing or not, or anything like that. Now, because they know, you know, I have to drop judgment, you know. Otherwise, I fail. I'm a failure. I'm still within this madhouse, this insane, rotting corpse of insanity. And I'm going to continue suffering. So they're only going for freedom. Untouched. Unconditional love that is totally untouched by any change or modification. That's what they're going for. That, you know, doesn't matter what the guru says. What the guru can say is, okay, you're a great teacher now, or you're this or that. Pff, who cares? Who cares? You either have it or you don't. You either drop judgment or you don't. So, you know, the inquiry is like, you know, they're inquiring, you know, like intense, not interrogation, but intelligent inquiry. Like, I have to get clear about this, really see it. You know, what is the truth? You know, can you really shed the light? I need light shed on this. I have to truly get there, you know, not academically, not intellectually, not conceptually, but actually drop judgment. And they need assurance, real assurance. And so the inquiry is to get that assurance. But most people are using inquiry to figure the guru out. They think this is a very clever one here, very clever. They found the power somehow. they found this non-existent power somehow. So maybe they're just lucky. They got lucky. They got blessed by it somehow. So I got to figure out, how can I be blessed by this too, or how can I get to steal it from the guru? How can they get them to share it with me? Or all these you know things are in their minds, and so the inquiry has, it's all colored by that. It's colored by that. The motive is different. Motive is different here for most. The mood of the satsangs are like that. You know, they say, did you say this or that? Or do you want to say it this way? Or would you rather say it this way? And so then they get the notes, and then they say, so next time they're going to make sure they say it the right way. So the guru will say, oh, good, you said it the right way. And they say, okay, are you going to share your power with me so I can have the entitlements and my life can be, you know, free of this burden of, you know, maintenance, gosh. You know, so I can buy new clothes every week, every day. Get someone to clean my clothes, dry cleaning service. I want that, you know. I want maid service. I want, you know, someone to cook for me. And I want a driver. I want a gardener, I want an administrator, I want an aide-de-camp, you know, general coordinator, I want a booking agent, I want a lawyer, I want an entourage, I want traveling companions, I want money to get whatever I need, I want all this stuff, you know, that's what we all want, you know, so to speak, that's what we think we want in this world, which is hell. It's not a joke, you know. I exist within the levels of maintenance, so I know it through and through and through and through and through. It's terrible. Yeah, it's not like, you know, it really is terrible. Absolutely is terrible. So, make sure that your inquiry is going to free you from it forever. Not just this lifetime, you know. If you gain entitlement this lifetime, which some do, okay. There are those who have put themselves up as teachers who have got this high level of entitlement and lifestyle, and they have everybody to take care of everything, all the dirty work, you know. And what's that? A bird just... Is that a baby bird, or what is that? I gotta make... Because there's a cat there. I gotta make sure. Okay. No, that is the cat. Okay. Okay. I don't want the baby birds to come out of the nest and the cat get the baby birds. The cat is waiting for the baby birds to fall out of the nest someday. Don't want that to happen. You know, there are those who do this game, the guru game. They get the entitlements for this life, okay? For a while. Maybe it slips away. Scandal rocks them or something. But it's only for this life, you know. They're going to find themselves back in this rat race again, desperately trying to figure out how to get entitlement again, and the whole entitlement landscape will have changed on them. So what worked for them one life won't work for them in the next life. Guaranteed. Guaranteed. I had, my previous life, I had entitlement through my own efforts. It wasn't bogus, but I had it because I was very, very creative. And I could afford to pay for anything. And so I did, of course. But, and then this life, my talents and skill, the creativity was been there, done that kind of thing. And so I couldn't make any income. And so I didn't have any entitlement at all. And so I couldn't pay for any maintenance at all. So I sank down to the low level of maintenance, you know. So guaranteed, just because if in one life you have entitlement and you get to be insulated from maintenance, it doesn't mean you'll have that the next life at all. So forget about this life, whether you're high or low or anything. Go for freedom from all lives. So you're free from the cycles of rebirth. Entirely free. Go only for that. Because that's the real prize. The other is just a booby prize. So your inquiry has to be, you know, coming from that. Saying, I want to literally be free of existence forever, of any maintenance world situation forever. Never want to be part of that anymore. I want the burden of judgment. I want this whole burden, this massive burden I feel, to drop away forever. And then, and so then that fuels your inquiry. You see, that fuels it. That's a different level of inquiry. And rarely is that found today. Rarely is it found. It's hard to get a teacher like Anandamayi to come into the world now, especially here in the West. I mean, for what? For what? Waste of time, you know. I mean, how much real inquiry would there be? I see some satsang teachers who may be legitimate getting bored. You know, it's like, where's the inquiry, you know? They're just saying, wow, what am I going to do? What am I going to do here? What am I going to do? And maybe some genuine teachers here, they just get so bored, they kind of end up trying to generate some inquiry, and then they get into trouble. That might have happened in various situations. Trying to drum up business, you know, they end up going off the tracks and slipping into judgment again, and they get a lot of problems for themselves that way. But I see it. I see the teachers are kind of bored here. It's like, wow, you know, where's the inquiry? Where's the inquiry? Instead, they're getting this academic thing, like how can, entitlement thing. Just, you know, people say, you know, if you just help me get free of all this burden of maintenance here, then I'll get into real inquiry. But first you gotta, you know, help me out, do that. And, you know, that goes nowhere. Because the struggle to maintain a lifestyle here is ceaseless. Even the rich struggle, believe me. They gotta be on it, because somebody's in their back pocket all the time. And the laws are constantly changing. I mean, look at France. A lot of rich people in France have literally fled the country. You know, they had all this entitlement there, maintenance-free lifestyles, you know, and suddenly the laws are changed and say, we're going to tax you, you know, 75%, and boom, they fled the country. So, you know, new laws, new regimes can come in all the time. Whole thing, entitlement things can shift and change on you, constantly shifting and changing. And right now that's, you know, going on in the United States, where there's all these extreme battles over entitlement. That's what's all about. Let's just be entirely honest. It's all about entitlement in this world. It's all about entitlement. It's what everybody's fighting for. It's saying, I want to be entitled to live a maintenance-free life here. And that means that, you know, I need others to do the maintenance for me. And so I want to have that entitlement, because we know that, you know, you have to have that entitlement somehow, whether it's class, race, money, social status, or, you know, whatever. And so there's always this intense battle here, because those who have done the maintenance work, they don't want to do it anymore. They want to be on top. It's a dogfight. The world is a dogfight. It's dog eat dog here. That's a fact. There isn't this wonderful out playing, you know, of God's grace. And, you know, I know that sounds great, you know, but you know who the people who are teaching all this stuff are the ones who have entitlement and have others, can pay others to do all the maintenance work for them, most of it. Those are the ones who are saying, isn't it wonderful? Isn't it great? The world is exactly the way God wants it to be. Of course they're going to say that. Of course. If you were on top, of course you're going to teach that God is in control of this world and everything is the outworkings of His grace here. Of course you're going to teach that. Almost all spiritual teachings on this planet have simply come from those who are trying to maintain a position of entitlement or try to gain a position of entitlement, that they're on the bottom, they're trying to get to the top, or those on the top trying to maintain their entitlement status. That's where it comes from. Of course they're going to say, if you're in an advantageous position, you're going to give a teaching, you're going to teach the maintenance people, saying, hey, guess what? This world is all God's grace. Everything that happens here is because of His grace. And wherever you are, that's exactly where you're supposed to be right now, all this stuff. Of course you're going to teach that. And it's absolutely false. Absolutely false. But, you know, if you're in an advantageous position, you're not going to say it's false. You're not going to be willing to see that it's false. Because who in an advantageous position wants to fall down into being a maintenance person? Nobody. Not a single one. If they say they do, they're lying. So I was in a position where I should have reached a position of entitlement, high entitlement, but I didn't. One second. Right back. So I got so sick and had so many problems, I was unable to make money, and I fell down into a non-entitlement situation, having to do all the maintenance, etc. So, and basically now I'm an indentured servant. No way to get out of it. So I didn't want that. Terrible. But it's so terrible that I decided, hey, I got to get free of this, not just for this lifetime, but forever. So, you know, nobody in a position of entitlement is going to inquire into the truth.
No! Wait for me! Wait!
Somebody's running down the street. Some child is freaking out there. Well, we're all freaking out on this planet, right? So nobody in an entitlement situation really wants the truth to be taught. They want truth to fit their entitlement situation so they can claim that where they're at is exactly where they're supposed to be at, and that God, this is God's will that it be this way. See? Of course that they want that. So they're not going to make deep inquiry into the teacher. They don't want the teacher to tell them to say the truth, because then maybe the maintenance people say, well, wait a minute, you know, you're not any better than I am. You know, I mean, what is this entitlement stuff? That's nonsense. See? It gets dangerous to the ruling classes, to the entitlement classes. They don't want truth. And of course the people on the bottom who are so anxious to get on top and for them to have entitlement, they don't want the truth either. Because if there's no entitlement at all, then how are they going to get on top? So nobody wants the truth here, really, except if there's a class of renunciates, which is, you know, which was what India has and had, and in sometimes in the West they had the renunciate orders. The people, the church said, we have no vocations this year. Nobody, not one person took a vocation, type of thing. You know, vocations in Ireland are, for the Catholic Church, are down to like one or something. You know, so. No, the renunciation is not in vogue now. Why? Because everybody thinks they can find entitlement somehow. They're going to get lucky, they're going to get smart, they're going to figure it out, get really aggressive, etc. Renunciate, it does have entitlement, but because they're dedicated to the welfare of everyone, of helping showcase how everyone can be free. So that's respected. That's respected. But there isn't any more so without or enunciate order, really, in this world. Nobody wants the truth. And then, so they're not going to inquire into it. They're not going to really inquire, you know. Some people from the middle class, you know, me, like in my situation, my suffering is so terrible. I do inquire. How do I get free of this? But I don't want to, you know. I don't even want entitlement, really, because I know it can be taken away. What good is that? What good is entitlement in this world? I've already experienced it, you know, what it's like, and then having it taken away, losing it. So many things can cause you to lose your entitlement. You know, just look at history. People who've had entitlement, you know, just look at, like, the in Russia, you know, the middle class, the business class, they had entitlements, right? Gone with the wind. They all got sent to the gulags. You know, happens all over the place where people who do have entitlement, tables are flipped. And now those who didn't have entitlement before, now they have it. Of course, they say, we're really here just to make it all equal, but it never ends up that way, does it? Never. Nobody wants it equal. Nobody, if they have the means, nobody wants to do the maintenance work. Not on an ongoing basis. Not the real stuff, you know. They don't want to go out there clean their windows twice a year. All the windows on the house. They want to clean the gutters every year, twice a year. Do they want to set all the traps for the gophers? Do they want to repaint their house, repaint this and that? Do they want to do all the dusting, all the cleaning, all the vacuuming? Do they want to do all the dishes? Do they want to do all the preparation, food preparation every single day? All the marketing? Everything? On and on and on and on endlessly? Do they really want to do all of that if they didn't have to? Or do they want to be taking a vacation at a you know, 4-star, 5-star resort on the big island of Hawaii? You kidding? You kidding? Of course they'd rather be sipping some, you know, tropical beverage on a beach of a 5-star resort, and then taking a hike up into the, you know, up in the volcano, and paddling and whale watching and you know, on and on, all the stuff that, you know, people have entitlement and money do. Of course they'd rather be doing that, you know. That might be, of course I'd like to be playing golf, you know, in some, you know, beautiful golf course. Yes, okay. You know, of course. Actually, I prefer to do this right here because I know it's freeing me from this whole insane hypothetical scenario. Forever. Freed forever from it. So that's what I, you know, that's what I prefer doing. Satsang is for the wise. It's not a class. It's not a class. When I say there's no teacher, because there's no class. There's no class. This is serious business. There's no classroom. This isn't like a classroom at a university where students go and to get a grade, and they said we need this credit in order to graduate. There's no class. This is totally serious business. Because people are suffering. Not only, you know, when you find out in maintenance, you get sick. You can't afford to get sick. If you get sick, you die. You don't have money to be, you know, for doctors and these kinds of things. Can't miss work. Can't miss work. You know, if you're sick, you have to go to work. Doesn't matter what happens. If you get an injury, you have to go to work. You know, there are people who know how to work the system. You know, like those who are, you know, but from my experience, you know, you don't work the system at all. They have no knowledge of that, and it's a shameful thing. You know, so either you have the money if you get sick, or you can't get injured. Either you have the money to support yourself, or you don't. You don't turn to the government for anything, basically. So, you know, it's a terrible situation. And so inquiry is a serious thing, because you get sick, you die. You know, you can't work anymore. You're in the gutter, you die in the streets, homeless. And, you know, it's brutal, brutal. Life for maintenance people is absolutely brutal throughout history, which is why everybody's struggling to get to those upper classes, entitlements. absolutely desperate to get entitlements, and electing politicians who'll give them those entitlements. Of course. Can't get around it. You cannot get around this world. And anyone who says you can is a liar. You have to drop the world. So there is no world. It's only unconditional love. And that's what we're all entitled to. That's real entitlement. So we need to focus on true entitlement rather than trying to get some kind of worldly entitlements. So it's Satsang is not a classroom. It's a coming together of desperate souls. Desperate souls. If you're not desperate, there's no Satsang, there's no inquiry. Because if you're not desperate, you must have some entitlements. And you're really saying, how can I protect these entitlements? Which means, how can I at least be happy this lifetime? Which means you're not really looking to dump all lifetimes, all of existence. You've got to dump it all at once. The totality of it has to go. All judgment has to go at once. And we have to see that all judgments are equally meaningless. All of them. So it all has to go at once. You got to drop all future lifetimes, which means all future entitlements. It also means all future non-entitlements. Think about that. You know, it means you're going to drop a lifetime of being a high roller. And you're also going to drop a lifetime of being a maid, you know, scrubbing floors for your whole life. You're dropping that too. You're dropping, you know, vigorous health so that you can be real successful and have a country club membership. You're also dropping a lifetime of severe sickness where you end up picking up garbage on the side of a road. You're dropping that too. You're dropping all possibilities here in existence, most of which are extremely terrible. Only a few have the real privileged lifestyles that we, you know, that are touted to us like you do can have this, you know. Only a few have that. Percentage-wise, you know. It will always be that way. I mean, the idea that somehow if we all get our college degrees and all entitlement, that nobody will have to do the dirty work is, of course, just laughable. It's as if all the maintenance work will disappear. If we all have college degrees, there's no more maintenance work, really? The world will stop decaying if we all have advanced degrees? Is that true? Or is that just completely absurd? Completely absurd. What I like about the listeners here to this channel, the viewers, etc., is there are a lot of very desperate souls there, you know, that are just, you know, that's real. That's real satsang. So I try to address that. I try to say stuff that you wouldn't necessarily hear other places that, you know, very straightforward and not sugar-coated. Yeah, because desperation is not a joke. It's not a joke at all. I'm a desperate soul, absolutely. It's no joke whatsoever. It's terrible. Because, if I look at my life, there is no way for me to reach entitlement, really, in this life. Not through worldly means. Don't have the capacity, actually, to do that anymore. So this life is essentially going to be one of just, you know, dying in the gutter for me. If it plays out as existence. Now, if I drop judgment, make the final judgment, drop judgment, that's a completely different story because then there's no world. There's no me. There's no person. There's no me. There's no world. There's only unconditional love. And under those circumstances, then it's a different outcome. Different outcome. I'll end up getting help, you know. So there's those two outcomes for me. So one is wonderful. The other is terrible. So it's a desperate situation. When you see the choice you're faced with, it's a desperate situation. And so desperate souls are end up focusing, very wise, because they see, you know, hey, things. I'm going to end up, you know, in a John Doe, in a morgue as John Doe, you know. I mean, with nothing. Just, I'm going to lose everything. It's terrible. And so I'd like to avoid that. And then you have to realize, well, the way you can avoid that, but you then also simultaneously have to avoid all other potential outcomes in this world, as a person in this world. Of course, dropping judgment means the whole idea of being a person in a world becomes totally irrelevant. Okay? But as far as dropping judgment, you drop all future potential interactions, positions, etc., as a person in existence. They all go together simultaneously. So you know what you are is untouched by existence forever. Can never be touched. You can never be dispossessed of your true entitlement, which is reality. You're entitled to reality. Existence can never touch it. It can't touch it right now, but we're trying to see if it can. So that's why we seem to be touched by all this misfortune and struggle. You know, I know people, I have very close friends who have had extreme entitlement in their life. Literally a stable of servants, a stable where anything they wanted was voice activated. Simply say it and it's done like that. Just call the driver. Just make a call. Why is this blinking out? Hopefully I can get back to this. The picture just dropped out entirely. I don't know why. Ah, we're back. Wow, okay. Yeah. And they had connections to the very top. They had business connections to the top, political connections to the very top. There we go again, it just dropped out. Well, maybe that's what we need to do. We need to just drop out of judgment, right? Just like that, boom, picture's gone. So somehow this taping is responding to that. I did not click on the blank shot because the blank shot has no audio associated with it. So some reason this just went blank like that. Nothing. That. Okay, I don't know what's going on. I had to re-click it. It just keeps dropping out on me. Okay, but misfortune came to those people. They could not maintain their entitlement, really. They tried. Some of them have been able to, some not. Brutal. Brutal, brutal, brutal for them. Brutal. Terrible. You know, their money gets seized, you know. Their assets get seized. Lose everything. Terrible. For them, absolutely. It's not a joke. You know, the people I've seen, people with entitlement lose it all. And that is very brutal. They can't adjust. They cannot adjust, really. It's just they're just waiting to die, basically. Instead, they should get into satsang, really. That's a great blessing if they can meet up with someone who's very serious, you know. Meet up with a satsang is serious. It's not a classroom, it's a satsang. And you know, desperate people should be there, not attack oriented people, you know. But beyond that, desperate beyond that, they're saying, hey, you know, attack doesn't work. Forget about attack. Nothing works. What do I do? Nothing works, which is true. Nothing works in existence. Existence is unfair. It will always be unfair. It's inherently unfair. Cannot never be changed. Never be changed. Impossible to change that. It's unfair. Totally unfair. You know, and so what do? You can't do anything about it, can you? No, you can't change existence. But you can give up the cause of existence, choose a new cause. Choose a new idea. Instead of wanting to be prime creator, choose to just want to not be prime creator, to be what we really are. Then, you know, you're free. You're free of existence. Let go of judgment, and you're free of existence. Forever. Not just this lifetime. It's not like, oh, this lifetime I'm blissful. But no, you're free forever. Freedom is forever. Otherwise, it's not freedom. How can we say we're free when 10 years from now we're in jail? That's not, how could we weren't free? That's like saying, how can we be alive when, you know, 50 years from now we're going to die? We're not alive. We're just temporarily not dead. Or like in freedom, we're just temporarily not in prison. But no, freedom means... excuse me. There's a bug. Freedom means that we're always free. We remain free. That is freedom. So freedom from existence means we are never... we are not going back there. We are not going to choose to make our appeal to magic anymore. Because that's all it is. That's all that existence is. We're making some sort of... appeal to magic, and we can be entirely free of that forever. Freedom is forever. So in Satsang we're talking about forever. That's it. That's all that's being talked about, is forever, not just this lifetime, forever. So those who just want to kind of figure out, how can I be happy this life and the next life, will try to keep it going. That's not satsang. They're looking for a teacher to teach them how to do this. Satsang is looking for freedom. Satsang is not looking for a teacher. Satsang is looking for freedom. If you found a teacher, you know, you're missing it. What you want to find is freedom. And the real quote unquote teacher is freedom itself, that is appearing as a, you know, as a person, a body here in this world. They're perfectly free. And so, you know, they're not a teacher, because they're free of that. They're just freedom itself. And so that's all they have to share. That's all they have to share. And freedom is beyond anything that can be learned. Cannot be learned. And it's not just for this life, it's for all. It's for any life that could arise, any possibility that could ever arise in existence. You're free of that. You're free of it. You're untouched by it. You're untouched by it. It can still be there, but you're untouched by it. And you know it has no relevance to your identity whatsoever. It never will. And of course, if we're free, we're not going to spend our time looking at the play of absurdity. You know, why? Yeah, for a little chuckle, but why? Why would we not do that? Just so we have this translated into reality, direct experiencing. Being, direct experiencing, that is beyond what we can even imagine or talk about here. So this has been, you know, time well spent, since we are still imagining ourselves to be in time, because we're still appealing to magic. We have to spend time wisely. We have to recognize our desperation. Everyone is really in a desperate situation, except they don't see it, because they're limiting their viewpoint to just one life. You know, the great advantage that was given to me was I saw my previous lives. And then I looked at this life, and I see it in that context, and realize, oh my gosh, you know, wow, just because you're up one life doesn't mean you stay up, you know. And then comparing this life to others, I say, oh my gosh, I've fallen down completely from the penthouse to the outhouse. And then that brings a desperation. You realize that existence is a desperado. It's a desperate game, and it's a losing game. And you're going to lose more than you win. You're playing against the house. You're gambling against the house in existence. And nobody wins. Nobody wins that game. The house is always going to win. And so you're always going to lose. It's a losing game. And the loss is brutal. No mercy. No mercy. Let me tell you for sure, there is no mercy. This game has no mercy. Because it's appealing to magic, thinking that it has to succeed. So, if what you're doing doesn't work, and you're no longer the fashion of the day, you're nothing. You are nothing. if you don't have a means to help others stay entitled, support their entitlements, you're nothing. I've experienced that. Like when I had a little bit of money and I was spending it, everyone was my friend. I'd walk into a store and, oh, hey, how you doing? And great to see you. And it's like, you know, brother and sister or friends or something, you know. It's like part of the family. And then didn't have any more money. Walking in the store just to observe and to look at stuff, etc. They had no idea who I was, and like I didn't even exist. And if I asked them the time of day, I wouldn't have gotten it. That is a fact. Literally, you think your friends are lifelong friends. You know, if you don't have no means to support their lifestyle of entitlement, to help them hire somebody to cut their grass, you're going to find out that they're not going to even answer your phone eventually. So, you know, that's a desperate situation. You lose your allies. Alliances in this world are, you know, you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours, and let's see if we can get ourselves out of this pit of doing the dirty work here. And if you can't help them that, doesn't matter who you are. Doesn't matter who you are. You're a nothing. You're a nothing. Doesn't matter. Make no difference. It doesn't even matter who you used to be. You know, some big stars die penniless and without any friends, lonely, you know, without any medical treatment. Used to be huge stars. Everybody loved them. That's the truth. So existence is a desperate situation. Those who realize that, they automatically show up in satsang. Along with others who, you know, want to say, you know, I just want to hang on to what I got here. they're too afraid, you know, I don't want to be too serious with satsang because I might lose what I have, you know. I got to play it careful, play it safe, you know. But if you're truly desperate and you've already lost everything or you're about to whatever, you know, it's a come on, let's get to it here. No fooling around. I wish the teachers would make a covenant with satsang and say, this is what I'm here for. This is the covenant that I'm going to stay true to this, and, you know, no fooling around. Either they're renunciate or they're not. You know, either they're here for promote social agendas or not. You know, either they're here for this or not. Just say, you know, this is what I'm here for, and period. Lay it on the line. But, you know, they play it 2PC. They're afraid, you know, if they lay on the line, nobody will come. Because people say, well, this teacher's not politically correct. And if I go there, I'm going to lose my entitlements. Because if you're not politically correct in these days, you are running the risk of losing your entitlements entirely. Losing your job, losing your friends, losing your reputation. I mean, it's unbelievable. Unbelievable. What can happen? Look at the Joe Paterno situation. This like guy was one step away from God, and now, boom, you know, losing it all, so to speak. I mean, and he lost his life already, but his reputation, you know, good name, everything is getting torn down super fast. You know, so that's just one instance, but to illustrate the basic principle, it doesn't matter how much good you do during your life, if you do the wrong, make a misstep in the wrong way, that's, you know, make one misstep, lose everything. You'll even lose your friends, you know. Amazing. That's scary. It is absolutely scary. You know, right or wrong, however you feel about it, it's still scary, right? It should scare everyone. It should scare everyone. Nobody should think themselves so high and mighty because, you know, laws and rules and the way society decides entitlements change all the time. And the way you used to be that gave you entitlement, if you're that way now, you're going to find yourself on the bottom rung, which is, you know, I've experienced that because in a previous life, I had tremendous entitlement. And then I continued those patterns of behavior, et cetera, in this life and got me in terrible trouble. And, you know, dark. Everything changed. PC constantly changing. One group that was, you know, on the bottom is now on the top. And you have to, you know, bow and worship them. And you can't just dismiss them like that, you know, because then they'll just say, hey, you know, you're shining my shoes now. That is a fact. That is a fact. If you know your history, you should be a desperado. You should be desperate. If you know your, the people who don't know history, they're the ones who are fools. And they're not desperate. You see all these people in the world, none of them are desperate. That's what I see when I observe people. I say, where is their desperation? Any desperation? No. Everybody's just happy. They're comfortable. They're saying, I'm getting some entitlement, you know. I got the dishwasher. I got the nice car. I got the gardener. I'm working on some other stuff. And, hey, you know, like, things will be pretty good. Yeah, well, pretty soon you might be working on just trying to get food, you know, in the world. Pretty soon the world's going to find entitlement stripped away severely from a lot of people. So, the wise are desperate, really desperate, because they say there's no answer, I mean, in existence. Nothing works. They may be depressed, you know, really depressed. But, you know, I got out of depression by just becoming even more desperate. People may be suicidal. You get out of suicidalness by being more desperate, because you realize suicide only cures one life. You're going to be reborn. You have to go through the whole darn thing again. The whole nightmare again, which is crazy. So, you know, you get more desperate. You say, no. I don't want to die. I want to be freed from existence permanently. And if you remember your previous lives, you know that death doesn't free you permanently. So I know a lot of religious teachings say you die and that's it, which makes everybody comfortable, right? They say, okay, I don't need inquiry. All I need to do is die. But I found out it's not true. I said, I know for a fact that if I don't get free forever, of all existence forever, I'm going to be taking another birth. And anything could happen. It could be even worse than this. Like anything at all could happen to me. And that's total desperation. No way in the world do I want another birth. Because I know that death doesn't do it for me. So that leads to inquiry. Show me someone who believes that death is the answer, and I'll show you somebody who is not desperate, who is not into inquiry or not into satsang. Why, what's the point? All they do is need to wait, you know, for a little while longer, and they're going to die, and they think they're going to be saved. So I tell you what, when I see if this is on autofocus. When I experienced my previous lives, no, it's not on autofocus. Okay. That was the single most important event of my whole path of inquiry, because it really started the inquiry. Kicked it in high gear. Guy said, oh my gosh. I know my previous lives. I know what the life was like. I know this, and I know this one. I see what's happening. I have the same patterns that I used to give me entitlement. They're not working anymore. I have a whole lifestyle that isn't working anymore. I can't sell my creativity anymore. I don't have a robust kind of constitution where I can, you know, do heavy work or business kind of work, because I was so specialized. I can't get out of the specialization mode, try as I might, and I'm too, everything I see, everything's working against me. What worked for me before, it's all working against me now. And it's like terrifying, and I couldn't change it. So that's when I said, you know, I need to get free of existence permanently, and death is not going to do it. So what is going to do it? Then when I got serious, what happened? Boom. Jesus Christ showed up with A Course in Miracles for me, as well as his New Testament teachings. Ananda Maima showed up, boom. Ramana Maharshi showed up, boom. And then I saw them and I said, oh, they're free. They are free. I could tell right away they're free of existence, the cycles of existence. So boom, I have to say, how do they do it? Oh, I don't know, come on, inquiry, boom. What's the answer? All ears, all ears. And then I didn't get it one day, next day, all ears, all effort, all ears. Like that. So the desperate, you know, are all effort, all ears. And, you know, people, viewers here on this channel, actually view these videos, spend the time to do it. Because they're all ears, all effort, all ears. other people, you know, 2 minutes, yeah, forget it. I got to go work on, you know, making more money so I can keep my entitlements going. But no matter how much money you make in this world, you're going to lose it. You're going to lose your entitlements here, no matter what entitlements you get. Like I said, I'm not going to be specific here. I know people that were connected to the highest, highest levels of entitlement in this world. Directly connected to people, to leaders who had the highest type of entitlement, literally, and they lost it all. They had some of the highest levels of entitlement, you know, ever in this world. They lost it all. Terrible. And even the leaders, they lost it all too. You know, look at the leaders in the Middle East and the Mediterranean, the Africa, North Africa. Look at all those leaders, right? Look at the leaders in Iraq. Look at the leaders of the world, and what happens to them? They had extreme entitlements, right? Look what happens to them. Look what happens to those who follow them, you know. There's a lot of people in the Bay Area that came, fled from various regimes when the regimes toppled, etc. And they used to be very, very wealthy there. Some of them got their wealth out, some of them didn't. And they had very strong entitlements there. And here, some of them able to get their money out. Others didn't. They lost their entitlements. Yeah. So, of course, the wealthy are always trying to maintain their entitlements. They'll do anything. They'll do anything to maintain it. Anything. Like the French fleeing the country. They'll, you know, say, let's go live in Great Britain. Great Britain says, come on in. Bring your money in. They'll literally leave their country. Absolutely will. They'll go to another country and set up shop there. Transfer all their money. People right now are transferring their money from various countries into the U.S., United States assets. Wealthy people making a ton of money in various places, but they're making it in such ways that they could be thrown in jail at some point. They're transferring their money over here, buying property like crazy, assets, businesses, constantly. Hedging their bets. Maintaining their, but they're not in satsang, right? Because they're too busy hedging their bets to try to maintain entitlement. Satsang comes when you realize that no matter what you do, you're going to lose. You're going to lose. It's a losing game. And no matter how well you do this life, you're going to be born again in this world, and the world is going to beat you to pulp. And the more honest you become, the more difficult it is to come to maintain entitlements in this world. You know, I tried to do it through just beautiful creativity in a previous life. I was a very honest, very highly regarded person. And I reached entitlement through creating very, very beautiful music. And that made people feel peaceful and multidimensional and all this stuff, you know. It was very, very advanced stuff. But I still lost all that. See, it doesn't matter how you get it. But by being super honest and fair and helping people, charitable, I gave all my money away before I passed away. I gave it all away. As I learned my life, I helped everybody I could. If people couldn't afford something, I'd pay for it. But being that way, it's hard to maintain entitlements in this world, because you have, you know, ruthless struggle in this world. People take advantage. I mean, they will absolutely trample on you. Like if you fall, like in a big crowd, you know, and some people fall and there's a stampede, you know, people just trample on other people. It's like that. You get trampled on in this world. So just because you think I'm a good person doesn't mean you're going to succeed here. No way. No way. So I realized that, holy cow, you know, this world is a nightmare. So I gotta get free of it. Gotta get free of existence. Buddha didn't say, you know, learn to the art of living. He said, free yourself from existence. And Anandamayi Ma didn't come here to teach us the art of living. She said, you know, you've got to, all of us have to go to the death-free realm eventually. In other words, maintenance-free realm, reality. Got to. She says existence is wicked, entirely wicked. It's impermanent. It's nothing, she said. Everybody's desperately chasing this nothing, completely ignoring, you know, their freedom. So, you didn't see Ramana Maharshi coming here to teach the art of living. You know, he says, abide in the self. Otherwise, you know, you're in misery. You're in a state of insanity. Nothing permanent here. Nothing but impermanence. Nothing but suffering. So, the heavyweights tell the truth. Really, they do. They really do. And then I just, you know, have made inquiry into those heavyweights, so I'm, you know, sharing what I've gotten through my inquiry. I'm not a heavyweight, but I certainly want to get free of existence forever. So, and that's right effort. So if you have that desperation, you're making, you know, that's right effort to apply that in the right way. Not through attacking anyone or attacking the world. That is wrong. That is very much wrong. That's trying to tear down others so you can gain some entitlement, you know. Attack is never justified. We're not looking at that at all. And don't attack yourself either. Don't attack yourself. That's not the answer either. That's not freedom. You don't free yourself that way. You free yourself through clarity, through making the final judgment that all judgments of existence are equally meaningless. There's nothing to judge because it's all equally futile. So there's nothing to judge. Nothing to judge. That is how you get free of existence. I guarantee you this is true. It's something that I know intuitively is absolutely true. There's nothing to judge. Existence is nothing. Literally, it is literally nothing. So, how could there be anything to judge except to say that it's, to realize it's nothing? That's how you get free. So we have to continue in that direction with the blessings and the help and the support of the real heavyweights of history, the heavyweights that are here now. I hope some of these gurus, teachers who are now actually, in hindsight, will be seen to be heavyweights. Absolutely, that's my hope. At this point, I don't know if they are. I don't know how it's going to work for them. I don't really know. And they may be heavyweights. It's just simply we don't put them to the test properly with genuine inquiry because we're not desperate enough. We keep thinking that this science and technology is going to give us all entitlement. You know, that's really the great lie that science and technology gave to the world. And I remember in the 50s, I was young, then growing up in the early 60s, that's what we were told. I guarantee you that's what I was told. And that's what caused me to be submerged back into insanity, is that, and back into futility, delusion, is that everyone said, hey, you know, science and technology is going to save the world. Everyone's going to be entitled. We're all going to have robots doing all the dirty work for us. We're all going to be entitled. We were told that. We were preached that. That was the cultural construct, the paradigm of the time. We look at the world now, right? We're all happy. We're all having fun. We're all entitled. Most are still hoping for it. But I tell you what, entitlements are slipping through our fingers. There's a nasty drought going right now in the United States. Could be a lot of problems. A lot of problems are coming. Entitlement is being stripped away from us. I guarantee you, every single day, more entitlements are stripped away from those who have had them, and more entitlements are given to those who haven't had them. It's a vicious, vicious process in this world that is taking place constantly right now. Every day has been taking place. It's constantly taking place, but it's accelerating to an enormous extent. And it is very purposeful and very intense right now. Nobody's entitlements are safe at all. And if you can see that, you're ahead of the game, which is why I talk about the problems that come in this world, just so you're ahead of the game. I mean, a lot of people can see it. I'm just validating it, saying, yeah, entitlements are going to be stripped away big time, big time. And, you know, history will show you what happens. Same old here. You know, the Duchess, or the Grand Duchess is on the street now, rummaging through garbage bins. Dying on the street. If she's lucky, the rest of her compadres are, you know, dead in the gulag, dead and buried. And that's just, you know, history repeats itself over and over and over and over. It's a dogfight here. As again I said, those who are on top always preach a spirituality and a teaching that tries to legitimize the order as it is. That it's all God's play and just let God play, you know. In other words, it's saying to the rebels, you know, don't revolt, don't revolt. If you revolt, you're going to be cast into hell. Right? That's what they say. That's what it is. Come on. That's the truth. All this idea of being cast into hell. I mean, existence is hell. What do you mean be cast into hell? This praying to magic is hell. Trying to propitiate nothing is hell. Trying to search for some power that doesn't exist is hell. We're already in hell. So of course, if you have entitlements here, you're going to teach those who serve you that this is the natural order. This is God's natural order. And that if you try to upset this natural order, you're going to be burned in hell forever. Of course, you're going to teach that and try to get everyone to believe that and believe it yourself. Complete nonsense. Total nonsense. So much teaching in this world is just total nonsense. Just made up stuff. Completely made up. And everybody quotes these teachings, right, to support their own position. The rebels quote it to support their revolution. The entitlement class is quoted to support their rulership, their right to rule, because, you know, yeah. Spend your time in satsang. And even if these teachers don't turn out to be true heavyweights, if you, as you play, so you hear the song, the tune. So if you go there with the right intent to get clarification, you will come away with clarification for sure. For sure. So as usual, I get started, I get rolling, and it ends up being a long video because this stuff is important to say. It's not being said anywhere else. I don't hear it being said anywhere else. It's crazy. It's not being said because there's no very few satsangs of desperate souls, spirits saying, I see existence, I see how it is, and I got to get free of it. Because it's a nightmare. It's an unpredictable nightmare. And of course, there's all these people who think that they're going to get entitlement or they can hold on to it, who bring up these, make up these teachings about you're in control of existence. Whatever you want will come to you. Law of attraction, the secret, you know. You can get whatever you want if you just have to learn how to do it. Okay, that's just, you know, it's folly. That's not satsang. That is just thinking that there's some power that can maintain the state of entitlement. But again, who's going to do all the maintenance work? Don't you think the people who are doing all the maintenance work are busy conjuring up their power that they can, you know, get out of their hole? Of course they are. Of course they're going to psychics and card readers and tarot and all these, you know, whatever power they can come across. The law of attraction, the secrets, they learn, say, oh, I need some teaching that'll teach me how to get exactly what I want. I'm going to get the house, I'm going to get the car, I'm going to get the gardener, I'm going to get the pool, I'm going to get the pool person. I mean, if you want hell, just have a big house, a big yard, a big garden, a big lawn, a big pool, and some pets. And then you have to take care of it all yourself. That hell. Believe me, that is hell. Because that is just brutal maintenance. You know, people have those. They got a pool person. Of course they have a pool person. Comes every week. Takes care of their pool. They have a gardener. Comes every week. Takes care of their lawn and their garden. They have drip system on whatever they need. And they have got a maid that comes to the dusting. Takes care of the house. Cleans the house, you know, once every couple weeks. They have people come repair the roof, replace a new roof, new this, new that, whatever is necessary. They have somebody who walks their dogs, takes care of their dogs if they want to go out, and the dogs are taken care of. The animals are taken care of. They have the veterinarians. They can afford to take them in. Whatever's wrong, they take them in. They got all this stuff that supports their lifestyle. Because if you don't have any of that stuff, you will find your beautiful mansion with a beautiful yard and vegetable garden and flowers and your beautiful pool and your beautiful lifestyle and cars, everything, you will find that to be a living hell if you don't have the money to pay someone to take care of it all, because you will find your life consumed by trying to take care of it and failing. You know, the pool starts glowing algae, cracks, you know, appearing everywhere. You can't swim anymore. You can't maintain the house, you know, just all these troubles. Your cars, you know, it's too expensive to keep fixing stuff, getting new tires all the time, and your life crumbles. Terrible thing, horrible. So of course people, you know, they gotta try to maintain that all, and they gotta believe there's some way, some power. So of course they're gonna believe in some teaching that tells them those things. Of course, and teachers will arise who themselves want to make money, and they'll say, hey, you know, I'll tell you whatever you want to hear. I'll make up a religion. I'll make up a teaching for you, which is what they do. And then people believe in that. But satsang is for real truth, unvarnished truth, how to get free of existence forever, period. How to get free of this whole idea that you are a person in a world, you're a person in a universe. How to get free of that forever. How to get free of the burden of judgment forever, with no return ticket. Only that is satsang. That's the only thing that satsang really is. Everything else is just foolishness. It's just desperate dogfight for entitlement, appealing to magic, just making appeals to magic. Magic, come up with a belief system that'll give me everything, you know, give me everything, all my give me entitlements, and then give me someone to take care of all these entitlements for me. Give me a house with my own car wash, you know, and a butler. Of course, I gotta have a butler and all this stuff too. Of course, give me all that stuff, and then maintain it and make sure I keep it forever, and then my family, children. See, that's another thing. You might have it for yourself, but can your children maintain it, and your grandchildren maintain it, and your great-grandchildren maintain it? You know, it's one thing to get to the top. It's another thing to maintain it. Very difficult. As again, I have very close friends who have been at the very top and couldn't maintain it. It was hell to maintain it. Everybody's after them. They're all after them. You know, whatever they have, they're their targets. And maintaining it is way more difficult than getting at the top. Way more difficult. Maintaining it for your children? Brutal. Some of those who have children, like, used to live super privileged lifestyle, now they're struggling just not to starve to death. So, know your history. Know this world. Realize what this world is. It's an appeal to magic, and it's a brutal thing because nothing works. And the play of nothing works is brutal and has no mercy. And is very weird, very vicious, very violent, very cruel, heartless, troublesome, very full of sickness, full of changes, full of fights, full of conflicts, full of all that stuff. In a full-on desperation to come up with new inventions and some pills, and now everybody's fighting for health care, you know? I might lose my health care. Basically, I just work just to have, you know, health care. And, you know, eventually become too expensive. A lot of people can't even afford it. A lot of people don't even have it now. Can't afford it. Get sick, you die. Or you, you know, take some kind of pills, you know, spend whatever money you have on some kind of pills to try and do something. Or some people, you know, just go to emergency, you know, and say, you know, when they're really super sick, but by that time, you know, it's bad, desperate situation. So it's a good thing to be on the bottom of this world, because then you see how terrible it really is. When you're on the top, you don't see it. You're actually totally engrossed with trying to keep your advantageous position. Totally engrossed. So your children maintain it and their grandchildren maintain it. But when you're on the bottom and you got no, you can't go any lower, you see it. And you see, my gosh, this whole thing is completely terrible. You've got nothing to lose. You can just look at it honestly and see it. Say, holy cow, this place is horrible. And you don't have to come up with all these ridiculous teachings about how much God loves this world and how he takes care of it all and how everything is perfectly ordered here and how everything is taking place exactly the way it's all supposed to be and we're all getting exactly what we want and all this junk. You don't have to see, because you see and you realize that that's just a desperate attempt to keep the hope alive that you can get back to entitlements again, get back to other people doing the dirty work for you. That's the hope. And when you're really on the bottom and like and you lose your health like I did, then you realize you can't make any money. There's no way. You never get back on top. And so then you're willing to challenge those teachings. You say, wait a minute, you know, this simply is not squaring up with my situation. And then you challenge the teachings, and then you go beyond them, and they crumble. You know, they just realize, wow, you know, these teachings are just to keep a desperate hope alive that existence can work, that you can stick with it, because we're hoping that magic will come through for us. We think we've separated from reality, so we think hope, magic is our only hope. So our only hope is to stick with existence. Our only hope is to think we can get entitlements at some point. Some point our misery will be on top and be able to, you know, snack our fingers and have voice activated everything. Hey, give me a sandwich. Give me some food. You know, hey, I want to go here. And every, you know, you have all these servants. We hope we can have either servants or robots or whatever. So these teachings just keep our hope alive, because we think we separated from reality. Reality has been destroyed, basically, because we're unaware of it, have no memory of it. So how can we think otherwise? So we've so forgotten reality, we don't have a clue. So of course we think that this is it, existence is it. So of course we're going to try and find some way to, you know, get on top. So of course we're going to invent teachings that give us hope that we can make it here, that it's all fair. It's all existence, there's some divine fairness to it all. As if you just follow the rules, you're going to be on top. Okay, of course then you have to have others on the bottom to serve you. So you need them to not be able to follow the rules. So you keep inventing rules that others can't follow, you know, like... So you feel hope, like, well, you know, there'll always be some who are on the bottom who are sinners. And there'll always be some that are these sinners, and they're getting what they deserve, and they have to, you know, clean my toilets for me. You know, got to believe in that stuff. But like I said, in a renunciate society, very different. It's different. It's different. There's some drawbacks to it, but the advantages are strong, too. Because inquiry can be serious and not have to deal with all this stuff about maintaining position in the world, because renunciate society, automatically those position people are given a position of respect. They're renunciate, automatically if they need food, they're given food. If they need something, they're given. If they need transportation, they're given transportation automatically. No pay. They don't have to worry about it. And so they're then supposed to make the most of this opportunity. So they don't have to fight for entitlement. It's set in stone already. Set in stone. Whereas if you have a situation where there's no renunciate tradition that's set in stone, where entitlement is automatic, that if you take the vows and you become a renunciate, part of a renunciate order, set in stone that you will be taken care of. That your basic needs, wants, etc. will be taken care of. You know, dentistry. You know, now? I mean, you kidding me? Who has dental insurance? Who can pay for expensive dental work, you know? A lot of people cannot, for sure, cannot. I cannot pay for it, no way. And you know, I once had a tooth go bad and get infected. I had no money to pay for it. And I didn't want to ask anyone else for any money. And I came within about a day or two of dying. I was super feverish. The infection went through my whole body. And I literally would have died in several days. It finally, I asked someone, I told them what's going on. And I said, you know, I got to ask for help. I'm really sorry. And they said, oh, okay, of course I'm going to help you. And I got pulled. And I went on antibiotics and I saved my life. But if I hadn't have done that, I would have been dead. Dennis told me, you know, you get a badly infected tooth and you don't get it pulled and treated, etc., you're going to die. So many people in history have died through dental problems, infection. So many. Very common throughout history. And today, how many dentists do you know that do pro bono work? I can tell you how many I know. Zero. Zero. You don't have the money. You're out of luck. I would think. I don't know if dentists have an emergency room. You know, maybe if you go to a hospital emergency room and say, I've got this infected tooth, I guess there's maybe some dentist there that will pull it, you know. But you never hear about that. I've never heard about that. So, you know, dental insurance, very hard to get, extremely expensive. And dental work is very expensive. And our teeth can get infected any time, literally. I mean, I don't even know how it got infected. Well, I do. A filling came out. And I didn't have the money to fix the filling. I didn't want to, you know, deal with it. And I said, maybe it'll get better. I didn't know. And then the infection got through that filling and into the root. So if you lose a filling, you have to have it fixed right away. Right away. Right away. Of course, if you're on the bottom, you know, you may not have you may be living paycheck to paycheck. That's it. You have to choose between getting a filling or missing your mortgage or something, or missing your rent or whatever, you know. Happens to people constantly, all the time, all the time. It's desperate, desperate. Existence is desperate struggle for survival. And the more we try to fix it, the more problems we cause too, because, you know, it can get worse. Things can get worse. It's already bad enough. So, I'm absolutely in favor of a renunciate tradition being set in stone within a culture like India has had for so long. There's a reason why a lot of the gurus show up in India, because genuine inquiry is possible there. There's a reason why in the West we tend to have lightweights, and even worse than lightweights, because there's everybody here again is dog eat dog, survival of the fittest. Pretty much so. So only a few in the world now, in the West especially, and in India things are changing. They're losing their entitlements. Their renunciate orders are losing their entitlements, and so that's causing a severe problem. People become fearful of genuine inquiry. And here in the West, only, you know, a handful really are into really genuine inquiry. Like, say, I gotta get it. I gotta get it now. And this has to ladder. So, you know, what is the answer to that? What is the answer to that? Now the rest of the people, I guess, are waiting for the robots to show up. Which carries their own set of problems with them, too. Get free of existence forever. Forever, right? Don't fool around with thinking like, well, maybe just this life is a throwaway, but I'll come back next one. No way. No way. You cannot trust it. It is not trustworthy. There isn't some way of always staying on top in existence. There is not. There is not any such way. You can live a perfect life and be blackmailed. Someone can make up something that you didn't even do. And that someone from a privileged special group that is used to be on the bottom and now they're on going to the top, they can just, they don't like you, they'll make something up. They'll be believed, you won't be believed. You'll lose your privileged position. Even if you, you know, try to live a spotless life, you can be taken down by lies, innuendos, all the, you know, vicious tactics of the world. You can be taken down. Even if you work with the best of intentions your whole life, you absolutely can be taken down. So you cannot trust this existence at all. You cannot trust it at all. And I even have a hard time trusting this, making these recordings, but this one has held up. Thank goodness, thank God it held up, you know. A lot of times it doesn't. A lot of times it doesn't, you know. It's hit and miss. Existence is hit and miss. Sometimes you hit, sometimes you miss. It's a gamble. It's a gamble. Best you can say about existence, it's a gamble, and you eventually always lose. You'll always be on the losing side, more than the winning side. And eventually you get tired of that. You get to say, ah, man, no way am I going to take another birth and go through the hell that I went through this lifetime. And eventually, as you get serious, you realize that your education here and everybody here is just going to push, guide you in the wrong direction. So you don't want to return here for any reason, unless it's as a perfect witnessing the truth, like Ananda my mop. But she didn't have any desire to come here. She got the desire for inquiry pulled her into this world, and that came from India, because the desire for inquiry was strong there because of the renunciate orders. And she wouldn't stay at any householder's place. She only stayed at renunciate place for renunciates, dharmasalas, various places like that, temples, wherever. She would stay with the renunciates. And she always gave the renunciates top honor, you know, in her presence. Paid great attention to that. Renunciates were extremely important. Very, very, very perfect comprehension of this world and how important it is to maintain renunciate orders in this world. How all important it is. But being as that's not happening right now and is not likely to happen anytime in the future, and not in this world, not here now, it's all important to make right effort, even though you're not in, there's no renunciate order for you, is to find the best teaching, the best satsang you can find, and just continue on with it. And if you can, you know, go from this here to there, I kind of bounce around a little bit, find what's most helpful. All right, this cat is giving me the eye, saying, time for some food. Time for some food for me. Probably time for some food for you. So, very great. This has been time very well spent. And we've touched upon a lot of stuff here. A lot of stuff. And, you know, it just might just be causing this, you know, boom in you. Wow. It's, a lot of dust. Yeah, let it settle. Stay desperate, but intelligently desperate. Realize your goal is permanent freedom from existence forever. Freedom. Real freedom. Real freedom. Unconditional love. That's your goal. And you realize you must accept this. You must make the final judgment. You must realize that judging futility is itself the ultimate futility. All right, very great. That's it for this video.